Penguin Random House Audio presents Political Tribes, Group Instinct, and the Fate of Nations by Amy Chua. Read for you by Julia Whelan. For Mom and Dad, Sophia and Lulu, Coco and Push, and Jed. Introduction. Humans are tribal. We need to belong to groups. We crave bonds and attachments, which is why we love clubs, teams, fraternities, family. Almost no one is a hermit. Even monks and friars belong to orders. But the tribal instinct is not just an instinct to belong, it is also an instinct to exclude. Some groups are voluntary, some are not. Some tribes are sources of joy and salvation. Some are the hideous product of hate mongering by opportunistic power seekers. But once people belong to a group, their identities can become oddly bound with it. They will seek to benefit their groupmates even when they personally gain nothing. They will penalize outsiders seemingly gratuitously. They will sacrifice and even kill and die for their groups. In many parts of the world, including the regions of greatest national security interest to the United States, the group identities that matter most are ones that Americans are often barely aware of. They are not national, but ethnic, regional, religious, sectarian, or clan-based. In our foreign policy, for at least half a century, we have been spectacularly blind to the power of tribal politics. We tend to view the world in terms of territorial nation-states engaged in great ideological battles: capitalism versus communism, democracy versus authoritarianism, the free world versus the axis of evil. Blinded by our own ideological prisms, we have repeatedly ignored more primal group identities, which for billions are the most powerful and meaningful, and which drive political upheaval all over the world. This blindness has been the Achilles heel of U.S. foreign policy. Take the Vietnam War, arguably the greatest and most humiliating military defeat in the history of the United States. It's by now well known that we underestimated the extent to which the Vietnamese people were fighting for national independence, as opposed to Cold War Marxism. But here's something most Americans, experts and novices alike, don't know, not even today. Inside Vietnam, a deeply resented 1% Chinese minority historically controlled as much as 70 to 80% of the country's commercial wealth. Thus, a hugely disproportionate number of Vietnam's capitalists were ethnic Chinese, despised by the Vietnamese, both northern and southern. Because we completely missed the ethnic side of the conflict, we failed to see that virtually every pro-capitalist step we took in Vietnam was guaranteed to inflame popular resentment. If we had actively wanted to turn the Vietnamese people against us, we could hardly have come up with a better formula. This is part of a consistent pattern. To give just one more fateful example, on the eve of the Iraq War, the Washington establishment was aware of a divide between Sunnis and Shias, but repeatedly minimized its significance. At the same time, we failed to understand the centrality of Iraq's tribal structures and how they were key to where Iraqi loyalties would fall. As former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice acknowledged in 2017, we didn't probably understand fully the role of the tribes. American policy in Iraq was based on the conviction that ethnic, tribal, and sectarian divisions would dissipate in the face of democracy and market-generated wealth. In President George W. Bush's words, "Freedom and democracy will always and everywhere have greater appeal than the slogans of hatred." Instead, Iraq descended into a maelstrom of escalating conflict and violence from which it has still not recovered. A handful of critics had warned of this danger. I was among them. In 2003, in my book World on Fire, I urged caution, warning that in Iraq, everything, even freedom and wealth, has ethnic and sectarian ramifications. Because Iraq's Shias formed a 60% majority long oppressed by Saddam Hussein's reviled Sunni Baathist regime, I cautioned that democracy could actually catalyze historic enmities, with elections producing not a unified Iraq, but rather a sectarian Shia government that excluded and retaliated against the Sunnis. These circumstances would be ripe for the rise of powerful fundamentalist movements that are intensely anti-American. Unfortunately, this precise scenario unfolded. Domestically as well, elites in the United States have either not cared about or been remarkably oblivious to the group identities that matter most to large segments of ordinary Americans, including people they are supposedly trying to help. Occupy Wall Street, for example, was a movement intended to help the poor, but which did not actually include the poor. On the contrary, it was overwhelmingly driven and populated by the relatively privileged. It's not just that working-class Americans did not participate in Occupy. Many, if not most of them, intensely dislike and spurn activist movements. As a student from rural South Carolina put it, I think protesting is almost a status symbol for elites. That's why they always post pictures on Facebook, so all their friends know they're protesting. When elites protest on behalf of us poor people, it's not just that we see them as unhelpful. It seems they are turning us, many of whom have a great deal of pride, into the next meme. We don't like being used as a prop for someone else's self-validation. For a blast of irony, contrast Occupy Wall Street with a movement that actually is enormously popular among America's have-nots and have-lesses. The prosperity gospel is one of the fastest-growing movements in the United States. It teaches that being rich is godly, and that God will make people rich if they pray and tithe correctly. The number of poor and working class African and Hispanic Americans who belong to prosperity churches is growing exponentially. 3 out of 4 Hispanic Christians in the United States believe that God will grant financial success and good health to all believers who have enough faith. A Mexican-American student of mine, whose family members are now in danger of being deported by the Trump administration, recently wrote to me, "In my opinion, the prosperity gospel explains how much of my Hispanic family can be anti-Obama and pro-Trump, despite that being so obviously against their self-interest. It's a coping mechanism for poor people who feel hopeless in this world. Just a few weeks ago, my mom sent me a video of one of her favorite pastors Snapchatting from Trump's inaugural ball. My mom was so excited to see Trump welcoming in men she considers to be holy. For me, this is frustrating to no end." But the most important tribal identity missed by America's elites was the powerful anti-establishment identity forming within the working class that helped elect Donald Trump. Right up until election night, U.S. elites, pundits, pollsters, major media outlets, economic analysts, on both sides of the political aisle, had no idea what was coming. Race has split America's poor, and class has split America's whites. Even today, the tribal politics behind President Trump's election still baffles many. How could so many in America's working class have been conned by Trump? How can lower-income Americans possibly fail to see that Trump is not one of them? What these elites don't see is that Trump, in terms of taste, sensibilities, and values, actually is similar to the white working class. The tribal instinct is all about identification, and Trump's base identifies with him at a gut level, with the way he talks, locker room, dresses, shoots from the hip, gets caught making mistakes, and gets attacked over and over by the liberal media for not being politically correct, for not being feminist enough, for not reading enough books. His enemies, they feel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.